Stitchy time. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I put up a film showing you the techniques needed to shoot a panoramic image using a long focal length lens and explained the reasons why and the techniques and the steps you need to take to do the camera end. And if you get the camera end right, then this end, the editing, the creating of the pan stitch in Photoshop becomes really, really simple. So if you haven't seen that film, there's a link to it on screen right now. Give it a click, go and have a look, pop back here. So let's have a look at our images. First thing I need to do is get my screen recorder running so that I can show you what I'm looking at and go into Photoshop. And let's just bring up the first image. There we go. As you can see, it's a slice of bread. It's a little narrow kind of a shot. If we bring up the next one, you see how they kind of marry up. This little gap here between the rocks is this little gap here. And so they can be overlaid pretty much like, I don't want that to join up at the top there, pretty much something like, there we go. You see how they sort of match up. We bring in the next image. This is why it was so important to be careful whilst shooting these images to make sure that they can be overlaid and sort of joined together. I just want to see where that goes. It's something like, there we go, that's pretty good there, and so on. So as these sort of come in, you can see even in Photoshop, I'm just kind of line them up very roughly, and that's not very good. Let's see if I can get it in the right place. That's about right there. Now notice there's some little steps going on up there. That's because I didn't have the camera quite level, as I said in the last film. You can see how these sort of line up together, and we're going to stitch them together using a command in the automate commands in a moment. The care taken with doing a manual exposure has really paid off, because as you can see, if you look at these images, the exposures are completely consistent. I shot raw files just in case they needed a little tweak, and that could be done. I'm not going into that stage here. This is about doing the stitch. It's not about Lightroom and converting raws. But I shot raw files in case they needed changing, but they didn't. So all I did was chuck them into Lightroom and I just exported them as they are. And that's what you're looking at on screen here. We're not going to do post-production work on these before they're stitched. Let's just get them joined together. So let's just pull in the other images onto screen and I'll just roughly sort of show you what they are. Here we go, one more there. And you see how I've got my little sort of band of rocks on the right hand side in that image and then the left hand side in the next, so that they will sort of join up something like that. And here's our final image. And all you have to do to join these together is you go into Photoshop's File, Automate Commands, and then pop down here to Photomerge. Really, really simple. And that's going to open up this window. Now, down the left-hand side, you've got various opportunities to do different things. There are perspective controls and cylindrical, spherical. I'm not going into each of those here because you can experiment with those for yourself. But they will kind of flatten perspective. They will kind of give it a wide-angle lens look. They will do all sorts of stuff like that for you. I'm just going to leave it onto auto. Now, we can either browse and go and look for our files. We can just sort of pop in here and import them, but I've already got these open on the desktop, so I'm just going to click add open files. There you go, you see, and they've all just popped straight into there. And all you've got to do, no needles and threads here guys, you just click okay and away we go. You can see Photoshop is now doing its thing. It's now looking at the images, it's analyzing all the different little bits and pieces, the jaggedy edges of the rocks, etc., and seeing what matches and seeing what doesn't. It's then creating each of these segments onto a separate layer so that they could be repositioned by you if you wish to. I find Photoshop tends to do it really, really well. If you've been following any of my vids for a while, you'll notice I've got a new Photoshop, which is a pretty rare thing, isn't it? But I have. You know, and the newer software undoubtedly does things better. If you've got the old Photoshop, it doesn't matter. It's still the same command. It's still in the same place. There we go. You see how we've done it. Now, Photoshop has created this panoramic image here. You can see the edges of all the different shots going across the frame. We've got a couple of little gaps here where I didn't have the camera quite straight, as I said. And over here in our layers palette, you can see all the different layers. You see, you can switch them on and off. You see how it's found edges of things and kind of join things together. And it's interesting that you sit and use a little tiny slice of that particular image there, but it's done an awesome job. So all that's left for you to do is to crop it. So we're going to the crop tool. We don't want that stuff at the top, that empty space. So I'm just going to pull that down and remove it. There's another little gap to the left. Just going to pull that in there. Get rid of the empty space at the bottom. Had my camera been completely level, that would not have happened. Certainly not to that extent. But there we go. You get the idea. I'm going to bring that in a bit more because I quite like this rock down here in the bottom corner sort of popping up there. Yeah, I think that crops good. So let's click enter. There we go. We've cropped our image and that's what it looks like. Now the next step would be to do any post-production work that you want. Now that we've got our image, we just get rid of these originals so that we don't get ourselves into a mess with those. Pop that down. There we go, it's come out of that crop tool. I don't want that. There we go, just pop that down there for a minute and get rid of these. So that, now I'm still learning my way around Photoshop CC because it is slightly different. There's a few things in slightly different places, but you know, it's much the same thing. So any post-production work you want to do in Photoshop to kind of change colors, now's the time to do that. We join the images together, they're nice and seamless, they look good, taking care of that exposure, doing it manually has really paid off, and everything lines up beautifully. If you're gonna do any work in post-production, you can either save this as a copy, so you can come back and work on it if you wish. I'm just gonna merge the layers so that it becomes onto one layer, and then I can just take a little look at it. So let's just pop into our levels palette, see what that looks like. Histogram says it could be a little bit darker, and I agree. It could be a little bit more punchy. Just pull that down a bit brighter maybe. No, I'm losing a bit of detail in here around the white foam. I'll take that off. Let's have a look, see the difference. I'm hoping the video is picking up. There we go, so that's before and that's after. That's nice. I'd like to pop a bit more color into it. Control U or Command U on a Mac. And just bring up the saturation palette. Just push the colors up a little bit. Let's go to about, oh, let's go a bit mad so you can see the difference. Let's take it up here to about 20, 19. If I do the preview, hopefully you can see the colors change. So that's without and that's with. That looks quite nice. And so on. If you want to darken the sky, do a little bit of fiddly diddly, that's absolutely cool. But there's our image. If I just go and see if I can find the 10 millimeter image that I showed you at the start of the last, that's the wrong one, foolish. It's just, sorry, I'm doing this the wrong way. As I said, I am still learning my way around new Photoshop. It does a few things slightly differently. Let's just go and open up our 10 millimeter image, pop that in so we can compare the two. Let's zoom out a little bit. So they're the same kind of size. Now, if I zoom in onto those little rocks sticking out on our 10 millimeter image, you see how they start to very rapidly fall apart. They're completely pixelated. There's very little data going on in there at all. If I do the same thing on our long lens pan stitch, let's just take that out a bit. There we go. So you can see the image. If I just bring it in here on these rocks this time, notice those are not falling apart. We've got a lot of megapixels. It's probably starting to go round about there. And this image could probably do with a bit of sharpening in it, but we're not going into the Photoshop techniques of that right now. I just wanted to show you the stitch and the reasons you may wish to do it. So as you can see, 10 millimeter image, totally pixelated. We're zoomed right in bigger with our long lens pan stitch, and it's holding together beautifully. And that really is all there is to it. Now there's gonna be other software that you could use to do pan stitch. There's dedicated software out there. Photoshop semi-skimmed, I can't remember what it's called, Elements, will also have a pan stitch command in it. I don't know it, I don't use it. But there you go, guys. So that's how simple it is to create a pan stitch. And if you get it right at the camera end, like we did in the last film, it makes this end so simple. Go have fun, go play with it, and enjoy. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to be notified each time we upload one of our cool photography videos, or for more great photo tips, workshops, and training, come and see us at our website, photographycourses.biz.